All right, welcome to our presentation today. Thank you for joining us. This presentation is one of several presentations that are being offered as part of Open Education Week. We invite you to attend the other presentations this week. You can see the link in our library news blog with You can see the link to our library news blog with links to other presentations in the chat, and I'll put that in there in a moment. I'd like to read Idaho State University's land acknowledgement statement. So, this is what I found on the website. Acknowledging native lands is an important way to honor and respect Indigenous peoples and their traditional territories. The land on which Idaho State University's Pocatello campus sits is within the original Fort Hall Reservation boundaries and is the traditional and ancestral home of the Shoshone and Bannock peoples. We acknowledge the Fort Hall Shoshone and Bannock peoples, their elders past and present, their future generations, and all Indigenous peoples, including those upon whose land the university is located. We offer gratitude for the land itself and the original caretakers of it. As a public research university, it is our ongoing commitment and responsibility to teach accurate histories of the regional Indigenous people and of our institutional relationship with them. It is our commitment to the Shoshone-Bannock tribes and to Idaho State University's citizens that we will collaborate on future educational discourse and activities in our communities. Okay. Now I would like to mention just a couple things. This presentation will be offered by Liz Redd, and I will introduce her shortly. The format is typically a 20-minute presentation and then time for question and answers afterward. So, let me introduce Liz Redd. Elizabeth Redd is an assistant professor in the anthropology department at ISU. As a linguistic anthropologist, she researches Native American language revitalization, teaching and learning, and Native engaged research ethics. In addition to having earned her undergraduate degree in linguistics, a master's in applied linguistic anthropology, and a PhD in anthropology at the University of Oklahoma. She also has a master's in library and information science from the University of Illinois and a graduate certificate in college teaching. Liz's path to the certificate in college teaching began with her research. To better understand and support Native language revitalization, she had to dive deep into learning and teaching theory. This spurred an interest in applying student-centered, collaborative, and active learning practices and andragogy, theory of adult learning, in her own work as a teaching assistant. She completed a year-long seminar in best teaching practices and then enrolled in the teaching certificate program, which she completed while conducting fieldwork for and writing her dissertation. Liz has a deep appreciation for diverse student needs. As a non-traditional student, a single student of four now adult children, she knows the challenges of making ends meet while attending college. While earning her degrees, Liz worked many jobs to afford rent, tuition, food, and textbooks, including working in a maximum security prison as a short order cook, a tutor, a workforce trainer, a childminder, a writing consultant, a museum collection manager, and a librarian. While completing her dissertation, she worked as many as four jobs at a time. During the year she graduated, she worked simultaneously as an office cleaner, a standalone graduate teaching assistant, a home health aide, and a full-time manager of a university assessment office. Liz doesn't want any student to have to work that hard to make it through school or to ever have to choose between food or textbooks. Making course resources accessible and affordable is therefore a core value. With that introduction, we'll give the time to Liz, and thank you for presenting today.
Thank you for that. I'm very happy to be here today. I'm going to share my screen now. Yes, as you heard, the last year of my dissertation, the year I graduated, was challenging. It was a lot of work just to be able to afford to attend. And I really don't ever want anyone to have to work that hard just to work to afford textbooks or college. And so I'm really committed to making textbooks or course resources as affordable and accessible as possible. So today I'm going to talk to you about what I've been doing under the stipend. Thank you very much to the OER committee. Under the stipend for developing or finding, locating open education resources. I've been working on this for a course called a course that is Nature of Language. It is Anthropology, English, Languages, 1107 Nature of Language. And I've been working on a project called Linguistics for Conlanging. And I'm going to talk to you about how that's and how the iterative process of developing this work has come about. So first, let me talk to you about the course. Nature of Language is an online synchronous course. It is required for anth majors and ling minors and for ESL majors in education. It's also a general education objective 7 critical thinking question. A critical thinking course. So, this course is taken by students who are not linguistics majors. We don't offer a major here at Idaho State University. But it's also a course that is very challenging. It is both a science and a social science course. It is more science than students think it's going to be. And here at Idaho State University, it's not just an introduction to linguistics, it's also a linguistic anthropology course. As a Gen Ed Objective 7 critical thinking course, it is also extra challenging because students have to think in ways that they haven't thought before, very analytically. And there are a lot of language puzzles to solve. They not only have to work data sets to solve them for the solution, they also have to explain their reasoning. So you can see here the course overview. I'm not going to read it to you. You've probably read it by now. But it focuses on topics of how language changes over time, structure of languages, how language is used in the real world, and the relationship between language and culture. Here are the course outcomes. So they cover a wide range of topics. And this last one, construct arguments using linguistic evidence, is where the critical thinking explanation comes into play. As part of the Gen Ed Objective 7 critical thinking outcomes, they have to be able to frame arguments and explain reasoning. And this is what I've found has been most challenging for students in the course. So that's a little bit about the course. Let's talk about this in terms of problems and responses, because there have been a series of challenges and responses. And so I'm going to talk about the first problem. Textbooks are expensive. That's the given problem. That's the one we're all working on under open education resources. So at an average of 50 students a year in this course, the textbook I was using was $80, which isn't as expensive as some textbooks, but still, that is a savings of $4,000 a year for students in these classes if we eliminate that textbook and find an open access textbook. And that was my first step. That was when I submitted my proposal. That's what I thought I was going to do, and I did it. I found a very good open access textbook, Essentials of Linguistics. It was, I thought, fairly accessible. It had audio, so the author was actually, or set of authors, actually read the chapters aloud to students so that they could follow along, read, and hear. But it still had some issues. It was focused only on formal linguistics and not on pragmatics or how people use language in their everyday lives. And it was written to a an audience that was assumed to be linguistics majors. So it was fairly dense. It did explain the terminology as it introduced it, but it was written in a very academic style. It's a great book. I still very much enjoy it, but it wasn't a great fit for the students here who are not linguistics majors, and it wasn't a great fit in terms of the course needs. And no one was reading it. That's the other issue, right? No one was reading it. So why are we going to have this course in the class if, or this textbook in the class if no one's actually going to read it? So that was my first response. And then I realized I needed to do something a little bit different. So the second problem was that most linguistic textbooks out there actually assume that students are majors. They're written densely, they're not accessible, they're not very visually engaging either. They have lots of data. It's inevitable. You're going to have data in linguistics textbooks. But that data is also decontextualized or extracted. So Davis writes about how in the field of linguistics, linguists often treat data as if it exists outside of communities of speakers. And linguists don't provide enough contextualization for that data. She calls that extracted data. And Hudley and others describe how in the field of linguistics, there is a focus on North American languages and European languages, sometimes Australian languages, to the exclusion almost of languages from other continents. So this is the thing I also found in linguistics textbooks. So my second step was to say, don't need a textbook. Let's just not have a textbook and flip the classroom. So I started recording my lectures. And I had already been using short videos, crash course videos, and some other videos, and I kept those. And I started creating Moodle lessons. What I really liked about the Moodle lessons was that I could write the text in a way that was conversational. I could present it how I wanted. I could embed videos. I could also include self-check questions using H5P. Don't ask me what H5P stands for. I don't remember what that is right now. But it's a way that you can embed questions in a lesson so that they can take it like a quiz without even any points associated with it, just as self-check. And what I found was that the students, the learners in the class, were actually doing the lessons. They wouldn't read a textbook chapter, but they would do the lesson and read that content. And a lot of them even gave me feedback saying how much they enjoyed doing the lesson because it was accessible, because it was written in the way that I speak. I'm fairly informal in the classroom and in my presentation style. You probably figured that out. And I write the same way when I'm writing for students. And I put in fun examples and Easter eggs and little jokes, the same way that I do in my classes and my lectures. So they were doing the lessons. Yay, fantastic. It's basically a textbook chapter. They just didn't think of it as a textbook chapter. I think maybe because it was called a lesson instead of a reading or a textbook chapter, that really might have helped. I think also the fact that it was accessible, that I really broke it down into small chunks, helped. So this is an example of a first page of the very first lesson that I have in Nature of Language. Language, where does it come from? Do animals have language? This is actually one of the longer lessons that I have in Moodle. This one ends up being, I think, about 12 pages long. And about every third page, there is a self-check question. And the self-check question relates to the content in those previous pages. So this, what you see here is you've got, a small chunk of text and an image. And then I might, right after this, have another small chunk of text and a 5-minute video for them to watch. And then another small chunk of text and another image, and then a self-check question. And a self-check question might look like this. So this is, I'll read the question here. The video that they just watched gave us some different features of language. They define language as distinct and organized patterns of communication with a potentially infinite number of combinations. That's called discreteness. That's one of the features of language that is learned, cultural transmission, and voluntarily used rather than instinctual. This gives us a new feature. Prior to this block of text and question, we'd already looked at discreteness and cultural transmission. But this gives us a new feature, voluntarily used. So features of language matching to animal communication. That question is a little oddly worded there, but it should read, match the feature of language to animal communication. So they can choose which one of these animals has that feature. And students really enjoyed this lesson. So this is an example of the embedded self-check question in the H5P in a Moodle lesson. So the students were doing it and they were learning from it and they were coming to class prepared to do the work in class. One of the reasons to flip it, the classroom, was so that we could spend time in the classroom doing homework activities. Instead of having them do the homework activities on their own and struggling, we do them collaboratively in the classroom. So the class is very much like a math of language class. We do activities in the class, we practice with them, we go over the answers, we discuss in class. So they really need to be prepared for that. And while some of them will watch the lectures, I found that more of them will do the lessons than even watch a lecture, which is really interesting. But this brings us to another issue. At the same time, as I was creating these lessons in Moodle, I was also completing a Quality Matters training on designing online courses, and I was in the middle of redesigning the course. That's one of the reasons why I went ahead and applied for the OER stipend, was I knew that I was in the middle of a course redesign, and it was a good time to find new resources or to think about a different way to approach resources. One of the things I was doing in redesigning the course was creating a structure that supported a project. And the project is the backbone of the new course. That project is a Conlang project. Students in the class construct their own languages, brand new languages from scratch. That seems like an overwhelming thing to do. Yes, it can be. But if we redesign the class so that it supports that project all the way through, then it is doable. Now, why would I do this? Why would I ask students to take on such a big task? And that is because assessment data. When this is a Gen Ed Objective 7 course, and so each year I have to assess the Objective 7 learning outcomes. And what I found was that students had differing levels of achievement of the Gen Ed Objective 7 outcomes, depending on which project they chose in the class. So the previous version of the class had three projects that you could choose from. You could compare three languages, you could conduct a language experiment, or you could construct a language. Now there's probably some self-selection going on here because the students who chose the compare three languages option where the students who were already not terribly engaged and probably looking for an easy option. What I found is that they learned almost nothing in the course, probably because they weren't very engaged, but they also had minimal to no critical thinking skills development. Those who conducted a language experiment learned deeply about their experiment topic, but not a lot about the rest of the class, and had, again, minimal to no critical thinking skills development. But all the students who constructed a language learned across all the areas of the course and developed strong critical thinking skills. So I said, that's it. Everybody's going to construct a language. But in order to do that, I needed to completely redesign the course. So traditional textbooks for linguistics are usually organized structurally. So this is an image showing the structures of linguistics. From phonetics to phonology, you know, sounds to how sounds interact, to how we build words, how we build sentences, how all of this has meaning embedded. And then finally, what do we do with language? in real world settings. That's pragmatics. But for a conlang, you need to reverse that order. You need to focus on building a world first. And so we have to start with pragmatics. How do people use language? How is language connected to culture? How is language connected to biology? How is language connected to environment? We needed to tackle all of these questions first. But there's another confounding element here. I could just flip the structure of the course and be done with it in terms of reversing the order of chapters. But international phonetic alphabet takes forever to learn, and learners in the class need early and frequent introduction and reinforcement of how to use international phonetic alphabet so that when they get to putting the sounds on their language and thinking about how those sounds interact and how they interact with morphology and how phonology interacts with morphology and syntax so that they can make their language in the final stages, they need to have a solid foundation in international phonetic alphabet. So I went with a spiral curricular design that looks like this hot mess. So this is actually really clearly thought about and developed. It looks like it's a lot to think about. The students never see anything like this. This would overwhelm them. But basically, I start with the connection between language and environment and biology and language origins, and we introduce pragmatics. And then we go through the biology of speech, which is solidly in the linguistic domain of phonetics, and we introduce international phonetic alphabet. And as we move through the course from, this is the beginning of the course to the end is at the top. As we move through the course, we are introducing, teasing content that's going to come later so that it's not so alien when it does come. And we're revisiting content that we've had before so that we are constantly talking about how all of these elements of language are interactive and how they reinforce each other. I'm sorry, how they interact and how they reinforce each other. So I use a spiral curricular design. Okay, so we have one last problem. One last problem now, because ISU switch into Canvas. And Canvas doesn't play nice with H5P unless you buy an additional set of features. Not sure that ISU is going to be doing that. And in that case, my lovely new lessons that the students enjoy, engage with, and actually work won't work. So the next step is to move the lessons to Pressbooks. So the benefits of doing this is Pressbooks plays very nicely with H5P. It lives outside of any learning management system. So if ISU changes again, I can have my repository of all of my content in Pressbooks and use it regardless of the learning management system. It's also gives me the opportunity to, in essence, through those lessons, create a bespoke ISU textbook. I'm not going to call it a textbook for students. I'm going to call it a lesson book so that they don't get overwhelmed by this idea of, oh, I have to read this thing instead of I have to do this thing. And it's a living document that can grow with the course. It's also an iterative process. So we just decided to move to Pressbooks a few weeks ago. So it is very much a work in progress. So this textbook is being called Linguistics for Conlanging, a Need to Know Lesson Book. And in each lesson, there is text, of course. There are videos. There's the embedded lecture. So my lecture is embedded in the lesson. Self-check questions using H5P and collaborative activities that can be used in the classroom or could be assigned as homeworks, depending on the needs of the students. I am thinking of this for a wider audience as well eventually, but right now it is tailored specifically for ISU students. It is very much a work in progress right now. It's an iterative progress. So one of the things that I would like people to know if they're thinking about applying for the OER funding to do this kind of work is it doesn't have to be overwhelming and it doesn't have to be completed all at once. It's not something where you think, oh, I have to make this thing and it's product and it's static and that's it and I'm done with it. It can be a living, growing thing and I'm taking my time with it. I'm building lessons as I revise the course. I'm building the press books chapters a little bit at a time. I anticipate that it might be done next semester, sometime middle of the semester, maybe. But it's also probably never fully going to be done because I'm always going to be adding to it or thinking, this didn't work as well as I'd like. How can I change that? As we all do when we're teaching. So, this is what's been done so far. I have only a few of the chapters populated, but I have the table of contents. The preface is completely done, or the introduction is completely done. And then there are a couple of, that didn't work. I'm trying to actually type it in here. Let me type it in here. I'm dropping in chat for people who are here the URL to the press book so that you can go and take a look at it if you want to. I'm not going to give it to everybody out there on, in YouTube land because it's still a work in progress, but you can take a look and see what's happening with it. The introduction, it explains the course design and rationale, as well as the workbook design and rationale. And an additional benefit of putting this into press books is I'm up for tenure in the fall, and I can include this as part of my tenure packet, and I can include it in my teaching portfolio so that people can see what I'm doing. Because if it's behind the learning management system, the tenure committee can't see it. So it's an additional benefit of having it in press books. So I have some activities in there, noun classes and cultural worldview that has Cherokee language in it, Indonesian reduplication. You can see project stages 1 and 2. I'm in the process of revising stages part 3 through 5 to make the instructions simpler for students. That was one of the things that I tested last semester and learned from, and need to make it a little simpler this time around. And what's left? I still have to populate the remaining chapters, embed the videos, and do the and then create those H5P self-check questions. And then I need to go through an accessibility check with disability services, who are great and will do that kind of work for you. So fantastic work there. That is my talk. So here is thank you in a whole bunch of languages. And time for questions.
That's a fantastic presentation. I think that's that you're doing fantastic work. I'm pretty excited about your success with using the H5P and how that's been so beneficial for your students, including the idea of calling it a lesson book rather than a textbook. That's a really good idea. When you're using press books, I don't know a whole lot about press books, but it is an open textbook platform, right? So are you confined to the type of license that you have, or do you get to select the type of license?
I believe that I get to select the type of license. Right now, I'm making it an open education resource. It's only available, even though it's public, it's only available to ISU students because it's only available to who I share the link with. You can also publish it through Amazon and make it a for fee access book, but I'm not planning to do that. And I haven't looked too deeply yet into specific licensing, but it is an OER. In fact, the original, or not the original, but the OER textbook that I chose for the course, is hosted on Pressbooks. So this Essentials of Linguistics course is an OER, an open education resource, and is through Pressbooks. I'm just learning about Pressbooks myself. I've created one with the help of some folks in ITRC. For a training that we are launching here at ISU. But this is the first time that I'm diving into the back end of it to see, because when I did it before, I generated the content and someone else put the book together for me. So it's still looking a little clunky because I'm doing it myself, but it'll look all polished fairly soon. think there's a question in chat as well. What is the process for getting feedback from students? That's an excellent question. So I do a couple of things. I have reflections that we do at the midterm and at the end of the course. I have anonymous polls and surveys that I use in the course, and I do an anonymous plus delta a couple of times during the course. So where I ask students what's working for you, what's not working for you. And in the surveys that I do, I ask specific questions about which resources worked best for you, which didn't, why. And so I get a lot of feedback that way from students. Does that help?
I sure appreciate you sharing this with us because I'm now going to read your textbook because it's fascinating.
It's nowhere near complete yet because again, we just started working on it a couple of weeks ago.
I can then read it in chunks as you evolve it because
The introduction is a complete thing. The introduction is very complete so that you can see how that works. I don't like that it opens up on the front page. I'm going to change that to a table of contents opening up on the front page.
Oh, good idea.
The introduction, yeah.
How did you carve out time to do this?
That is the big question. That is absolutely the big question. So I am not treating this as a project that I have to sit down and do all at once. As I develop new activities for the course to support the project, I am then writing them up more fully than I normally would. Instead of it just being, oh, here's an activity, I'm doing the work of saying, here's the language that it comes from. Here's the concept that you need to understand, and then writing the linguistic background, the lesson intro for the activities. And then I'm taking that, and that's the first step. That's putting that into the press book. And then as I find time, I go back and just add a little bit more and a little bit more. A lot of it is taking the images that I'm already using in my lectures and pulling them out and writing what I would say in my lecture around it. But I'm not doing it all at once. I'm doing it just in time. As I create new content, I'm just taking the extra hour to develop that content more fully for a lesson chapter, which is why
Okay.
it won't be done by the end of the semester.
But I like how you're staying engaged with the project because you're doing it in small increments on a regular basis.
Absolutely. There's no other way for me, I don't think. I don't have sabbatical. I don't have large chunks of time to be
Right.
able to do this. Yeah.
I'd have to schedule even those 30 minutes.
I do. In my calendar, I schedule time to course prep, and that time to course prep is when I'm working on this and my other courses. And I schedule time for grading as well. My calendar looks like a kaleidoscope because I color code everything. In class time is dark purple, and course prep and grading is lavender. Just for fun.
Yes, thank you. This was great.
Liz, some people or studies indicate that open educational resources can sometimes result in fewer students dropping the class and students performing just as well as in other classes that have the for-profit textbooks. Do you have any feedback on this as an OER, or do students even recognize it as such?
Well, I don't have data yet about whether students stay enrolled in the class, but I can say that as soon as I dropped the expensive textbook and went to the OER textbook, my enrollment increased. And then once I changed the structure of the course from choose your project, traditional organization to Conlang, project, and that's the backbone of the course, the enrollment jumped again.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's really interesting.
I often get the feedback that this is the hardest course I've ever taken, but I love it. I'm having fun. I also get feedback, this is the hardest course I've ever taken. Why are you doing this to me? But I think that that's because it's a general education Objective 7 critical thinking course. Courses that are critical thinking courses are often outside the comfort zone, or expect learners to do the type of work and thinking that is outside of their comfort zone. And that can be challenging for a lot of learners. So trying to structure it around something that's fun and creative, and they can take with them, I think it has made a large difference. I get a lot more students now who are taking it just because they want to construct a language for their D&D campaigns, or for a short story they're writing, or just because it seems like it's more fun than just taking a boring linguistics class.
Fantastic. Isn't that interesting? Yeah, my thoughts are just that when something's relevant to their own personal interests, they're more likely to get engaged and want to be part of it. That's fascinating.
Yeah, one of the other things that I'm doing in the class with the project is using forums instead of the there's is it called workbooks? It's another Moodle feature where you can assign peer reviews, but I found that to be really clunky, and so I'm using discussion forums, and they share their project stages with the entire class, and they get feedback from their peers on their project stages. And so we're trying to normalize the fact that it doesn't have to be perfect right out the gate, that everything is a growth process and everything is revision, that revision is a normal part of learning. So if your project stage doesn't look polished and beautiful, and that's fine because we're all learning and growing together, and we're helping and supporting each other in our learning community.
Fantastic. Well, Liz, thank you so much for presenting. Are there any other final questions before we finish today?
Nope, thank you.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Liz, and we wish you success and all the best with these endeavors. And it sounds like you're already making a big impact on our students and keeping their best interests in mind. So we really appreciate and applaud the work that you're doing, and thank you again. If anyone else is interested in attending other Open Ed Week presentations, please use the link that was provided in the chat. Our library news blog is the place to go if you want to find access to those links. To the other presentations. We've got one tomorrow and one on Friday as well. So with that, I think we'll finish and call it a presentation. Unless, Liz, was there anything, any final remark you wanted to share?
Nope, just happy to do this. Thank you for inviting me. And I really love teaching, and I hope that shows here and to my students.
I think it shows. I'm excited and jazzed about the things that I've heard today. So it's inspiring. All right. Well, thank you again and have a great day, everybody, and we'll talk with you later.
Thank you. Bye.
Goodbye.